Hi, I'm Dr. Mark Salzburg, and on this show, we'll be discussing holistic hoof care for horses. So stay tuned to Pet Owners Hotline. Pet Owners Hotline. I'm Dr. Mark Salzburg. Tonight we are looking at caring for horses' hooves with natural foot trimmer Anne Daimler of Sound Hoofs Horse System. Excuse me. Welcome to the show, Anne. Thanks a lot,
Mark,
for coming. It's nice to meet you. So tell me, Anne, I know you told me you kind of come all this not that long ago, at least as far as I'm concerned. So tell me about how you got to where you are today.
Well, I was one of those little girls that was horse crazy, but my father was a college professor. We lived in the suburbs, so I never could have a horse. And I was 46 years old when I got my first horse, and I thought I was just going to ride off into the sunset on my horse. Ha! I learned, basically by doing, that it isn't that easy in this modern world to keep a horse sound. And my horse started having white line problems, which a lot of horse owners will be familiar with.
Tell me real quickly, what is white line problems?
It's where the, you can see it right here.
Just go ahead.
There. And where the wall separates from the sole.
Oh, okay.
And fungus gets in there, and it becomes a problem anyway, and the foot starts to fall apart.
So your horse started having this problem.
And so I wanted to learn about hooves because my farrier didn't seem to be able to fix the problem. And other horse owners said they had the same problem. So I went to a basic hoof seminar in 2001 in Ocala with Dr. Hildred Strasser of Germany. And what I learned there changed my life because what she talked about was giving a horse the life as close to what nature intended as possible, and trimming the hoof basically on the wild horse model so that the hoof capsule mirrors the coffin bone, which is the main bone in it. And I was very excited about that, and I wanted a stressor trimmer for my horse. Well, the closest one was in Vermont, so that obviously wasn't going to work, and my farrier wasn't going to have anything to do with it. So my husband suggested I take the course. So I took an 8-month course in hoof orthopedics and holistic lameness rehabilitation.
Okay.
And I became basically a barefoot trimmer who specialized in lameness issues. And I've been doing it now I graduated in 2002. And I've been doing it for about 13 years now.
And so did you start working on your own horse when you started to learn this stuff?
I had to because when I came back from that Strasser hoof, basic hoof seminar where I learned about it, I started asking questions and my farrier quit. He said I asked too many questions. And I had trimmed on cadaver hooves at that seminar, really a half a day. So I didn't have a lot of knowledge, but I was able to do a pretty good job on my mare, and I was able to help her white line problem. But I immediately signed up for the course. It started in September. And
now, was this course offered here, around here, or did you?
It was the second North American certification course, and I had to fly to British Columbia twice and Oregon once for practicums. But the rest of it was, I would take photographs of the hooves that I trimmed, and I would email them to the instructor, and then she would critique them.
Oh, excellent. Well, I just want to remind everybody that you can join us by calling with a question. Any questions about whatever we're talking about, horse hooves and treating them, at 1-800-901-9238. So, okay, so you have a horse, it has a problem, you decide that you're going to learn how to fix this problem. You go through this extensive training on treating these horses. And now you do what you call, I think you call it holistic
hoof care.
Hoof care. So tell me sort of general, and we'll get to some specifics later, but tell me generally, what is holistic horse hoof care involve?
It's more than just a trim. So the trim is one part and a very important part of it to have a physiologically correct trim. But it's equally important that the horse's lifestyle support healthy hooves. So I only trim horses who have 24/7 turnout. They can have shelter, they can have a stall if the door is open. Owners might have to get a little bit creative there. I advise owners on proper diet, on barn products, grooming products, tack, things that support the horse's health instead of that are basically designed more for performance or anyway, it like a type of saddle that's designed for a specific discipline but hurts the horse's back.
And which all obviously alters the way they
right.
walk. So actually the people are watching this now, they're looking at, you know, kind of getting ready to do a little bit of a horse hoof trim. And the first part of it, I think there was somebody sort of just shaving, getting that horse ready for you to start doing the...
I'm cleaning the foot.
Okay, so the first thing you start off is just cleaning the muck and stuff out of there, is that right?
I clean the foot and then I assess the balance, decide what needs to be done. I'm using my gauges, which I have right...
they won't be able to see that. We can show them when you come back.
And I'm marking her heel height so that I'll get that even and precise.
So you're marking those things so that you can try and get that foot back to level. Is that what you're talking about?
Actually, other than those marks for the heel, I don't trim to... by marking up the foot, I know what areas need to come off.
Uh-huh. Okay.
But I don't sit there and keep looking at the side of the foot and trim to those lines.
Right.
I trim to what I'm seeing when the foot is...
So you trim a little bit and then
it.
You put it down and look
and
see. And
then when I put it down, I can tell if it's where it's balanced and where it isn't. In that picture, I'm digging fungus out. This is a horse who was catastrophically foundered in 2004, and we'll see pictures of her rehab later on. And she still has fungus in her toe, and it's a constant battle digging it out. She's what's known as a metabolic syndrome horse.
Oh, yeah? And are fungal infections in hooves pretty common in Florida?
Very common. Not just in Florida, all over the world. It's an environmental problem.
And is that because, do you think that's affected because people aren't caring for the hooves appropriately, or is that just the nature of the beast here?
So we talked about white line separation. So if the foot isn't perfectly balanced, then you get a little separation between the wall and the sole, and that's a perfect entrance for fungus.
So.
And nails on shoes,
right.
The nail holes, the fungus can get in there.
So I know we talked a little bit about this, and I think that probably a lot of people, think of horses pretty much always having shoes on, and obviously you're kind of opposed to that approach. Tell us a little bit, why do people put shoes on horses? And obviously tell us why you think that's not such a great idea.
Well, people obviously will put shoes on if their horse is lame, but I always say if the horse is lame before you nail the shoe on, and then all of a sudden it's sound, but what will happen if you take the shoe off? If you take the shoe off, the horse is lame again. So you haven't fixed the problem. You've just masked it. And the shoe actually prevents the hoof from expanding and contracting, which inhibits circulation, and that inhibits neural function. And that's why they shoe a lame horse.
Oh, because that's the contraction and the expansion tends to make it painful? And they prevent that from happening?
It's not that the expansion and contraction is painful, but that the blood that pumps in and out of the foot with every step nourishes the nerves. Mm-hmm. So if the foot can't is if these heels are held by a shoe,
right,
and it won't expand, then the nerves aren't nourished and they don't fire. Now, eventually, nature will out and the horse will, the blood will get through and the horse will be lame again.
Now, how about horses that have to, you know, to perform on hard surfaces like, you know, like asphalt and concrete?
Well, I can ride my barefoot mare at a trot down the middle of the road and she's not at all lame.
She's fine.
She's fine. So what I say is that anything a horse was designed by nature to do, it can do barefoot, not just barefoot, but do it better barefoot, because it'll be more sure-footed.
Okay. So that kind of tells us, but in general, people put shoes on.
They do put them on. I put shoes on my mare. I put them on her because my dressage trainer told me that she needed them for support. Well, I didn't question that until I started having hoof problems, and then I said, wait a minute. The question would be, how does that support the horse? And it doesn't. All it does is put a layer of metal. It'll prevent wear, but it also prevents circulation.
Okay. That's a good point. I didn't think about that affecting the sort of the biology of the hoof just by not allowing it to expand and contract as they walk on it.
And a lot of people shoe because they're engaged in performance types of performance that aren't natural to the horse. And so a barefoot horse isn't going to stand up under that. But again, to me, it seems only logical that if the hoof isn't going to stand up under that performance, you can put that shoe on there to assist them. But what about the wear and tear on the joints and everything else? So they put sliders on reining horses so they can do those 100-foot slides.
Mm-hmm.
Well, it's not normal for a horse. And
right.
What does it do to the joints and the hind end?
Right. Yeah, I can understand. Okay, so how many horses do you work on an average week or so?
I probably work on between 15 and 20 horses a week.
I watched you getting down there and bent over. That's
got
to be pretty
tough. I taught good body mechanics.
Is that right?
Actually, I was an office worker for years before I started doing this, and I had more trouble with my back from sitting in a chair than I do now. I'm much healthier now.
Wow. Well, I guess you are. You're probably strong.
Oh, yeah.
Strong as a horse now, right, too?
Not quite. No.
Okay. So your whole thing or most of what you do is about trying to keep those feet in a healthy horse, to keep them in better alignment by trimming those hoofs accordingly. And tell me again, I know you mentioned a little bit, what was sort of the aim, is the idea to keep those bones in a more sort of what should be a natural orientation with the ground, right?
Whoops, just lost my navicular bone. so this is basically a leg on, I think it's a miniature horse.
Right.
And this is the coffin bone. Here's a coffin bone from a full-sized horse. It's basically pyramid-shaped. So if the heels are too high, then this bone is tipped on its toe. Eventually, the toe will erode. The other thing that happens is the sole gets compressed and you get thin soles. The other thing that happens is that heel goes up, the joints above it are out of alignment, and you can get arthritic changes. You might get side bone, ring bone, as the body tries to compensate for the imbalance in the hoof.
So over time, those sorts of things obviously have some pretty dramatic effects, not just on the hooves, but the rest of the... And it's a reminder, everybody, you saw that, what Anne was just showing us there, that you know, their horses are walking around on four toes. I mean, now they certainly have evolved that those toes are really big toes, but they're still four toes. So, you know, you think about it. Any one of those things has a problem, and it's going to affect the horse profoundly because they're big animals. And they, you know, where a dog or a cat can walk, you know, can keep a leg up and hold. Horse can't do that for very long. So
no, they can't.
That's why this becomes incredibly important in foot care and hoof care is, you know, obviously one of the most important things you can do. And I know that your kind of approach is along a lot of this holistic thing, which is treating the whole animal. But now you talk about movement, and you said that you all only work on horses. You want horses to be out moving. How does standing, you know, for longer periods of time, how does that affect the hoofs and hoof health?
It affects the whole horse because I think I mentioned the hoof mechanism, we call it, where the bone comes down and the hoof expands and contracts. Can you see this? Expands and contracts. As that happens, it pushes blood. The hoof is very vascular in the coriums, and blood pools, and when the bone comes back up, the blood is expelled out of the hoof, and it goes up the leg, and it assists the heart, because there are no muscles below the knee in a horse's leg. So something has to help bring the blood back up, and it's this hoof mechanism. So I think it's Dr. Robert Bowker, who's famous in barefoot circles as a researcher. He did he put pedometers on horses, and he put four horses in a paddock because they're herd animals. So one horse might stand in the corner all day, but if there are two, the bossy one will move the other one around, and they move all day. So I always recommend that you have more than one horse.
To keep them moving and exercising.
To keep them happy, because they're herd animals. That mental health is important to horses also. He found that the horses that were in the paddocks moved between 3,000 and 5,000 steps a day. The horses that were in the stalls for the same amount of time moved approximately 900 steps. And that's side to side or in circles. But it's, again, they're in a small area. It's not the same kind of movement. You can't trot, canter. They can't play in a stall. So that's one of my rules. I make exceptions in places like South Florida where they have very little land. Right. And so, but my owners down there are very creative about getting movement for their horses.
So I know you have kind of a case study that you were going to tell us a little bit about, where you took a horse that obviously was having some pretty significant problems, and through these trimming techniques over a fairly protracted period of time, got this horse to be pretty sound. Tell me a little bit about this horse.
It was actually the mare that was on the video, Cherokee, and she belongs to me now because her owner.
So this is a picture of this mare. This is how you kind of found her in the beginning?
That was in 2004, at the end of July, right before all the hurricanes came, she arrived. And she was, that's 3 months later, right before she went home, still lame.
So that first one showed her kind of really stretched out. Was that because her feet hurt?
That's the classic founder stance, where they're trying to take the weight off their toes, because the bone is up in the front of the foot.
Right.
So that's where all the nerve endings are and stuff, and it's very painful. Okay. So they rock back. And she also had, in that first picture, you could see marks not very clearly on her hip that were actually bed sores from lying down all the time.
Because her feet hurt so much.
Because her feet hurt.
Okay, so there's that picture again.
Yeah,
so she's bowed off, she's bent back, kind of trying to take weight on her rear feet.
That was the first, I think that was.
Now, do we have pictures of those hooves at that time?
Yes.
Were they really, did they get very like protracted or extended looking?
You'll see if we go to the next slide. I think they're going to be, yes. So that's her left front foot, and you can see the slit there towards the toe. That's where the coffin bone actually
came through
the sole and punctured it. And so her vet had said to put her down, that you couldn't fix that foot.
And so you start to do these trimming techniques, right?
And this is that same foot before I took the shoe off. And there was fungus in that foot. So her vet had resected it. But that's how that foot looked from the front when it arrived.
So that's looking at the front.
And here's from the side. The shoe had come off on the white foot, the right front. Mm-hmm. But you can see how deformed those feet were really, right. really, really deformed.
And the shoe was put on to help this horse just to get around, is that right?
To deaden the pain.
Okay, okay, I know we talked about it. So this is...
Really, those round shoes, they call them egg bars, and that is basically what they do is stop circulation completely. Your typical horseshoe that's open at the heel, if it's a lightweight shoe, you might get a little bit of expansion. But that's a really deformed foot there, and that black stuff is all fungus in the toe.
So then you start doing the sorts of things that you showed us in that video where you're trimming.
Yes, and that's the same horse. That was 3 months later, right before she went home, and you can see that her laminar connection, which is the connection of the front wall
right.
to the coffin bone, is growing in parallel to the bone. It's tighter, and the bottom half of the foot is the old unconnected, which is what happens. They lose connection. This is in March of 05, the following year. She still hasn't completely grown her toe out, but that's basically she's sound now.
And then this is the horse that you've obviously kept up on to try and keep her. And
she, and now this is not the same horse. This is a very healthy horse from the Pacific Northwest that's just come off a 4-day trail ride on the Pacific Ridge on that kind of terrain.
And this is a barefoot horse on that.
They had a pack train of a bunch of horses, 4 days. And that foot was, that picture was taken the day they came back.
They came back, so you can tell.
They can ride healthy on rocks.
Okay, they can ride healthy on rocks. And obviously healthy with, you know, barefoot. I mean.
Yes, absolutely.
And you don't think you have more issues with, say, the fungus and stuff like that when they are barefoot?
No, I think they have more issues with fungus when they don't have enough circulation or anything that punctures that hoof capsule, because that creates an opening for the fungus to get in. Now, I will say that like 20, 30 years ago, the fungus was not a problem like it is now. You could shoe a horse and you might have a little damage around the nail holes, but to me, the fungus has become the main reason not to shoe now, as well as the lack of circulation.
And why do you think that is?
You really want
to... Yeah, so, you think fungus are more potent and less responsive to therapies?
I think that the environment is a lot more acidic now. And I also read something on Facebook, and I researched it because you can see things on Facebook that are pretty crazy. But someone said something about, we all know about black fungus and Chernobyl. And I went, huh? So I Googled it, and when they came back in after things cooled down at Chernobyl, the only thing that was thriving was black mold and fungus. So we live in a more radioactive, more acidic world, and I think that black mold in houses, I never heard of that when I was a kid, and yet now it's common. And black mold in the foot, it's one of the two main reasons for founder.
Is that right?
It'll eat the bone.
Just gets there and tears it up. So tell me, now you do have this hoof here, and I thought you were showing me, just so people can kind of see, you know, the bottom of it where you have half of this is not been trimmed and the other half has.
Now this is, again, it has the separation. This was a cadaver hoof, and whoever trimmed this left half of it how it was when they first saw it.
You tilt it up a little bit there. There you go.
So you can see the heel buttress, which should be back here, is up here. The bar goes down like this and actually is up here on the sole. On this side, which has been trimmed, the heel buttress is back down here and the bar goes straight. To me, this hoof is a little bit over-trimmed. The bar is way down there, but that might just be from drying out.
Right.
And of course, they couldn't do anything about the separation at the toe. So.
Right. And so that separation happened before this horse became a cadaver, is that right?
It's probably why it became a cadaver.
Okay.
There was a lot of fungus in this foot too. You can see
right.
that this frog was pretty tatty looking.
So And you were telling me about that bar and how that's an important thing because that navicular bone sits right up above it. Is that correct?
The bone, the coffin bone sits in the hoof capsule up in the front. The navicular bone sits right there or right across here. In this bigger one.
It's just right above that area where that...
The bar ends halfway down the frog, and directly above it is the navicular area.
We're about out of time. I want you to tell everybody how they can get in touch with you. So give them your email. I think they're going to put that up there for people.
I think if they go to my website, soundhorsesystems.com,
okay.
My phone numbers, my email are on there. And can I plug my clinic?
Okay, well, thank you very much, Anne. I appreciate it. We're out of time. If you're not able to get your question answered about natural hoof care from Anne, you can email me at wdsc@daytonastate.edu. I want to thank my guest, Anne Daimler, for coming out to talk with us about keeping horses' feet healthy and sound. And thank you for joining us. We also appreciate all your questions. We hope that you enjoyed the show, and you will join me next week for another episode of Pet Owners Hotline.